Yeah, so I'm Holden. I'm really excited to talk to y'all about building reliable data pipelines. I don't know, maybe not everyone's excited about this topic, but I am. I think reliability is really awesome. Okay, so I'm gonna have a brief note about Spark, and that's for people who aren't super familiar with Spark. I imagine most people who have been at Netflix for like longer than 48 hours are probably pretty familiar with Spark, but for any folks who are new, or any folks from outside of Netflix, we'll just talk a little bit about Spark and why I'm gonna be rambling about it so much. I'm gonna talk about like sort of the dark times or when we have non-reliable data pipelines and where we wanna go, the happy place with our reliable data pipelines. Some of our data pipelines are already there, but the rest of our data pipelines wanna come and join them, right? It's a little bit lonely on reliable data pipeline island. And we're gonna talk about how to get there. And this does involve like there's the goat that's trying to eat the cabbage, so it's a little bit complicated. If you don't get that joke, don't worry, it's a old reference. Okay, cool. So Spark is a distributed data processing tool, and we use it extensively at Netflix. If you're not familiar with it and you're familiar with pandas, you can just think of it as about like 200 pandas all running around coordinated by one very lazy panda. And all kinds of fun. And you might be going, okay, why do we need 200 pandas? And so sometimes we can solve our problems using like a Raspberry Pi. In practice, most of our data doesn't fit on a Raspberry Pi. We have to use like three, just kidding. We have to use many of them. So sometimes the problems will fit on like one computer, and that's great, we don't need Spark. And sometimes the problem will have to fit on all of these computers, and then we need Spark. And before anyone asks, this is not a Netflix data center. We are in the cloud. This is my personal collection of servers, also known as bad mistakes, that I use for testing the changes that I do on Spark. And so I have all of these different servers for making mistakes and also for serving as illustration, because you can't really get a picture of the servers in the cloud so well. It's very difficult. They don't let me in. It's just, I don't know why. They keep saying like, you don't work here and please leave. It's no fun. Okay, so what is our problem? Why do reliable data pipelines matter? So reliable data pipelines, specifically Spark reliable data pipelines, matter because they tend to cause serious production outages. 47% of people in a survey, this is outside of Netflix, said that they had not caused a serious production outage. So that's like slightly under half are like, everything has been fine so far, which is, you know, not a great vibe. 20% almost said, yes, it had a serious production outage. And 30% were like, well, it depends on what you mean by serious, right? And so I view serious production outage as one where I like update my resume before the incident review. And like a depends on what you mean as serious is one where like the incident review was pretty short, everything's fine, and we had a nice easy fix, right? Bit of a joke, you know, hopefully you don't have to update your resume before an incident review. But I think the 19% here were probably having a rough day. And I think many of us have fallen into that 19%. And if you haven't, you probably like, these odds aren't great, right? Like you probably don't want to be betting that you're just going to stay in the slightly under half, right? Because your data pipelines are running frequently, increasingly so, and you don't want to bet that things are just going to continue to be okay. Hope is not a strategy. So what are some of the impacts of our unreliable data pipelines? So the first one, which I am most committed to, and this is because I'm trying to get people to upgrade to new versions of Spark. I think it's going to be super awesome. But one of the things that having unreliable data pipelines means is we're afraid to change them because we know the last time we touched them, they broke, and then we had to fix them because we were the last person who touched it. It's like why I refuse to work on Netflix date time functions. The last person to touches it owns it, and that is just not a good place to be, right? And this is why when we have these things that we don't understand, we're kind of scared of them. The other one is people are woken up at 3 o'clock in the morning, and not just you, right? Sometimes platform gets to join in the fun at 3 a.m. and be like, okay, we're gonna figure this out. This is all kinds of fun, right? But no one really loves the 3 a.m. pager duty sound, right? I don't, if you do, that's great. I'm sure there's SRE roles available, but most people do not, right? Now, at the end of the day, right, yes, we mostly do things related to movies. And so, like, stale recommendations are not the end of the world, right? Like, okay, you know, there are other things, though, besides just recommendations. Sometimes this can be, like, people not getting paid, right? If you look at data pipelines outside of Netflix, like, the impact of failures on data pipelines can have huge impacts in the real world. And I'm not saying that, like, our stuff is as critical as making sure, like, EBT benefits go out. Like, certainly it's okay to not refresh movie recommendations for a little bit longer versus the EBT benefits really, really need to go out. So, like, we can dial it back a little bit. But for those of you who are responsible for, like, real things, please don't screw up. Okay, yeah. And much, much more. All kinds of other impacts from unreliable data pipelines, some of which we can talk about offline, over lunch or coffee, if you find me. Otherwise, I'm hiding because I don't want to answer questions. Okay, so that's fine. Okay, we know that our pipelines are unreliable, or maybe you're not convinced yet. Maybe you're like, I'm in that 47%, everything's fine, nothing's going to change, right? So I think our pipelines are unreliable for a few reasons. One of them is we inherit a lot of responsibility, right? I have things that I don't know what they do, and the people who know what they do not work here anymore. They have moved on to different things, right? And I think I'm not alone in this. I believe many of us have the situation where we've inherited things and the handoff has maybe not been as smooth as we might hope. The other one is untitled_7.ipython notebook. And no offense to _7, _8 is just as bad. But it's the situation where, like, if we don't know what this is doing enough to name it, how am I going to make it reliable, right? Like, if I don't know what this pipeline is trying to do, how am I going to know? Like, sorry, I have feelings about this, especially because I have had untitled_7.ipython notebook break things when I stopped running it because I didn't know what it was doing. And then bad days. Okay. And the other one is, and I want to, like, as a platform person, I'm responsible for some of this, unstable tools, right? And I'm sorry, right? I'd be lying to you if I told you our Spark APIs were stable. I can't even say that without smiling. They're not, right? At the end of the day, we're working in a place where in many times we're at the, like, bleeding edge of sort of what's happening at scale. And because of that, a lot of the APIs are just not as stable as we would hope. And it's really hard to build a stable house on an unstable foundation, right? Like, people do it in California, magic, or at least they say they do. We'll find out, fingers crossed. And so, you know, it's hard for you. Like, the things that we're asking you to do are challenging. The other one is our data sources change. This is all kinds of fun, right? Sometimes the communication between data provider and data consumer is not as tight as we might hope. So we have sort of the situation where, like, things have changed, no one told us, and now, you know, Hannah Montana is incredibly popular. But maybe, thinking about it logically, Hannah Montana might not be our new top 10 movie, right? Just running that through with a little bit of thinking. And the last one is this push for real time, right? And now, like, admittedly, I'm a batch person, so I'm lazy. But I think increasingly we're getting pushed to provide insights quicker and faster, right? The business keeps moving. People who used to be willing to wait a day for something, they don't want to wait a day anymore. And so things that we used to be able to take time to manually check, that's not something that we can do anymore. Unless you want to be waking up at 3 a.m. every day to check your pipeline, you can't depend on sort of the manual checking that in some cases we may have historically. Okay, so we're going to go from a broken Ducati, this is my broken Ducati, by the way, to a hopefully running Ducati. And in this case, our broken Ducati is our data pipelines today, and our running Ducati is our data pipelines in the future. Although, actually, these images are more aspirational because my Ducati is currently broken again. But, you know, that's an authentic representation of data pipelines. They break frequently, but we're going to fix them. and this time it's gonna work. Okay, so you might be going like, okay, Holden, that sounds good and all. I sort of believe you about like data pipeline quality, we should work on it. Why should I listen to you? So first off, my name is Holden. I guess that's probably been self-evident from the introduction. I'm on the Spark PMC. That's kind of like a committer with tenure, except it's the parts of tenure that aren't very good. Like you're guaranteed the work, but you're not guaranteed the pay, right? They can't get rid of me, but like there's no guarantee that I'll get someone to pay me. So it's not great. I've also written a bunch of books about sort of distributed data processing. I think they're pretty cool, but also I'm probably pretty biased. The main reason why you should trust me is that I have broken a lot of shit. And I have cost a lot of money doing that. And it's great to learn from our own mistakes, but even better is to learn from someone else's mistakes where you don't have to update your resume before the incident review, right? So take this opportunity to learn from the mistakes that I've made. Also, I'm told that we should say a Netflix show that we like, and I really like The Diplomat. That was kind of cool. That is no particular reason to trust me about data pipelines, but you know, if you're looking for an old school movie recommendation, that's probably going to be out of date. Yeah, old school movie recommendations. Okay. So what are we going to do? So the first step is to figure out what it is untitled_7.ipython notebook is trying to do. Then we're going to write tests based on figuring out what it is we were trying to do. And then we're going to add some runtime checks based on this. This is another broken motorcycle. This one is a broken Vespa. I have a lot of broken bikes. It is totally fine. Everything is fine. Okay. So that's good, but many of us know that we need tests already, right? Like if we came from sort of a computer science background, the idea that we needed these tests is already there, right? But somehow they might not exist, right? So why is that? Why haven't we necessarily made as many tests as we might want? One is like we inherited the code, right? So in that case, it's not our fault that the tests aren't there. It's whoever gave it to us. And that's great because those person tends to not be around to take the blame. So that's a wonderful person to blame. The problem is you're still responsible for fixing it, right? The other one is coming up with good data for testing is kind of hard, right? The real world is incredibly creative, much more than I am. You know, I'm just not going to think that people can live in the city null. But somehow the real world is going to come up with that, right? And the other one is like things can get pretty slow. Spark's unit tests itself take over 3 hours to run, right? And so there's kind of this like, well, why would I add more tests if everything's already so slow? And like we can work around with that with some parallelization. But I still think even though it might be slow, we should still do it because, you know, we want to move fast, but not so fast. It's okay to sometimes just add that extra 5 minutes to make sure that we don't get woken up at 3 o'clock in the morning. Now, another one, and I think we do a lot more auditing or validation at Netflix than I've seen at other companies, and that's really awesome. I'm super proud of us. But we don't necessarily do it as much as we should. And if you're, you know, watching this at another company, you might be going, why don't we do validation? So one of it is like manual validation is slow. So we don't do that. That's too much work. There's the beliefs that our tests work. Often I find that coupled with the lack of tests, which is an interesting intersection of ideas. And the other one is like distributed computing makes it harder, right? If we're working on a local computer, it's a lot easier to validate things. There's a lot of tools to do validation. A lot more metrics are available to us, and it's, you know, distributed computing just makes it hard. So it's hard, so we don't do it, right? And I think we need to make the right thing easy. The last one is that it's flaky, right? No one likes to get woken up at 3 o'clock in the morning, especially by a flaky validation check. I think we can solve that by just not having our validation checks wake us up at 3 o'clock in the morning and just having them trigger during business hours instead, and holding the data pipeline when possible. Okay, So let's say you're like, okay, that sounds like a cool story so far. How are we going to go from the broken Ducati to the working Ducati? So we've got sort of like our classic Coke flavor, golden set unit tests. We're going to talk about sort of how we can scale those up beyond the scale of what runs on a single computer. We're going to talk about where we can get our data. And we're also going to talk about the times when we are simply not creative enough, but somehow the computer is, and it's going to make really cool test sets for us. So like kicking it back old school, classic golden set test, right? The important thing here is like we can do this with Spark, right? It's not that hard. We have to mix in another trait so that we can do our testing with distributed Spark, but this works pretty well. Now, of course, as many of you will notice, there's a collect function here. And if you've been in our support channel, you know that collect is the source of all sadness, or at least 50% of our sadness. So you're like, okay, well, this is great and all, but I know this test definitely isn't going to scale beyond like the four elements that you've got here. And that's true. That's true. This test is, it's good, but it's like, it's the Diet Coke, right? Like we're not all the way there. Okay, so how are we going to go to like the full flavored, full body? So we want to actually test with more than four elements, because a lot of problems only show up with five elements, or in our case, 5 million. So we need to test the partitioning, right? Like all of us have had, many of us have had problems from partitioning. Many of us have had problems that show up from the serialization and the reading and the writing, and we can't just use parallelize and collect to do those tests. The good news is Spark has these built-in distributed set operations that we can use. And so instead of collecting the results back, what we do is we ask Spark to compare two RDDs or two data frames, and there's built-in tools inside of Spark Testing Base that uses these distributed set operations to do comparisons on RDDs and data frames. And that's not perfect, right? For example, we will not notice that someone stole one of our coffees here. Coffee, coffee, panda versus coffee, panda are not the same because someone has taken my second coffee. But, you know, also it's not that bad. It's okay. And the important thing here is we can still do our classic golden set style testing without having to limit ourselves to the amount of data that's going to fit on one computer. On the other hand, though, we're also probably not going to write out a list of all of our samples, right? Like that does not sound enjoyable. So where are we going to get the data from? Also from my survey, it seems like most people generate the data by hand. That does not scale. I cannot write the amount of data by hand that does not fit on one computer. My fingers do not move that fast. And I imagine yours don't either. Now, if you're lucky, you may have some production data that you can sample. Often this is the case. Less so with certain kinds of production data. And that's sort of the trade-off, right? Sometimes we can sample production data, and that's sort of like the best case scenario, because it's like what we're actually working with. And so having that gives us a really good idea of if things are gonna like fail for real. Now, the downside of that is that only gives us the kind of data that we've seen already. It doesn't give us the new kinds of data, right? As our schema evolves or people add new things, if we've got these old sampled records, it's not gonna keep up. So in our wonderful happy world, we can just give the computer this problem for us. We can ask it to generate the tests for us. If anyone's played around in Haskell, you've probably used Quick Check, which is really, really cool. I think it's one of the coolest things about the language. But Scala has its own version of this called Scala Check. And Python users have their own version called Hypothesis. All kinds of cool. And we can make them work with Spark. Okay, one person was excited. That is all right. This is maybe not the coolest test in the world, right? Here, what we're doing is we're saying that the number of elements should not have changed. But the surprising thing about this test is this will actually catch a large number of logic bugs, right? If we replace the map with our actual business logic, this kind of test can catch cases where we fail at handling empty partitions, or we fail at handling key skew. This relatively simple property assertion can actually catch a surprising number of bugs. And it's, I think this is really cool because I am incredibly lazy and this test does not take much time to write and catches a whole bunch of bugs that are really hard for me to think about conceptually and remember. Now that being said, by default, this isn't actually going to generate a million random digits. We have to tell it like, please, you know, go up to a million random inputs or whatever your desired random target is here. And it will go ahead and check this property for you. So that's awesome. The other really cool thing that I think exists about property-based tests is that if you're thinking about sort of what sort of properties or invariants hold true about your code, you can express some of those same ones when it comes time to write the validation, that is the online checking of your program to make sure that it's behaving as expected. And here, you know, we had to say we were generating RDDs of strings, but if you're working with data frames, the really wonderful thing is we can just say like, hey, take my data frame, generate things that match that schema. We don't even have to say what the types are. It will magically do the thing for us. This is great. I am lazy, much like my sleepy dog here. So we can just have the computer do things and we can go back and take a nap. Heck yeah. Okay. Now, that being said, even doing these tests can be slow, right? And even if you were only testing locally, testing Spark locally has some additional overhead. And so I think it's important that we look at things, and as cool as the Spark testing libraries are, not everything needs a Spark context to be tested, right? If you've written a UDF, you can probably just test it with regular Scala or Python tools, and that's going to catch a lot of the same problems a lot faster and a lot cheaper, and with a lot easier to read stack trace. Those Spark checks, stack traces do not make any sense, even to me. It's been 10 years. I do not know what they're saying. And so if you can avoid using Spark for your tests, that's great. You still should have some integrated Spark tests, but skip them when you can. So what do I mean by that? I mean, take your thing, which has this like inline RDD operation, and split it out. So you've got a concrete testable regular function and your special RDD logic, right? Or replace RDD with data frame, et cetera, et cetera. It's relatively simple refactoring most of the time, and it just makes it that much easier to do your testing quickly. And this is awesome, right? Like with our property testing, everything just works. It's all cool, and we can test at scale, provided that we connect it to a cluster. Because if we try and test 1 million entries on Jenkins in local mode, you're going to have a bad time, but it's okay. You can connect it to one of your clusters or replace Jenkins with GitHub Actions or your preferred CI/CD system here. Okay, so that's cool. How can we go beyond just testing, right? Like maybe we've written some great tests, but we're still getting woken up at 3 o'clock in the morning and we really don't want to, right? We want to throw our phone into the ocean and light it on fire. Don't do that. Bad for the environment. Also, hard to light phones on fire in the ocean. It doesn't work. Okay? Not from personal experience. So in the old days, we might look at things, take time, consider how they work. And by olden times, I mean back when people drew things by hand and thought. We don't have the time for that. So we've got to get the computer to do the validation for us. The computer is going to say whether or not things look like we expect them to look. So there's all kinds of different validation that we can have. We can write static rules. We can write rules like, hey, we expect the number of, you know, dropped records to be greater than some value or less than some value. We can say we expect today to look kind of like yesterday or like the last 10 days over some average. We can do things both with our data. And also importantly, we can write validation rules about Spark's internal counters, right? So Spark has a lot of metrics that it's got going on. And for example, a really good validation rule could be like, hey, if I read less data today than yesterday, that is probably not good. Something has happened. If it's like, you know, within 1%, okay, whatever, push to prod. But if it's like 5%, well, let's maybe take a break and see what happened. Like maybe this is something and our filters have just gotten better. Maybe someone removed some data, everything's okay, we should still approve it. Or, you know, maybe there is missing data and we shouldn't update our recommendations because there's only one movie and it's the Hannah Montana special and not everyone wants to see that. No offense to Hannah Montana. Right, okay. So what do people actually do for their validation rules? Outside of Netflix, in practice, from my survey, not a lot. It's kind of disappointing. So in practice, most people seem to just check the file sizes and the amount of time it takes their job to run and go, okay, this is not great. You should do more than that. You should at the very least say like, hey, are my file sizes okay? Do I have sort of the dimensionality of the data that I was expecting, right? Like if everything became null, that's also maybe not great. So like, is the distribution of my data kind of similar to yesterday? Or, you know, if you've got something with a periodic pipeline, you know, same as last year, modulo some amount. And yeah, so please do more validation, everyone, please. I can't buy you all cookies, especially those of you over video, but know that if you write good testing and validation rules, I am buying you cookies in my heart. Right? Every time I get to sleep through 3 o'clock in the morning, I am dreaming a little dream of the really, really happy data engineer who is not getting woken up. And they're really, really happy platform support folks who are also not getting woken up. And we can all just like have that happy dream at 3 o'clock in the morning when we're all getting to sleep through the night. Okay. Also, how do people do these things? So inside of Netflix, we have fantastic tools, which is part of why we have more validation tools. Outside of Netflix, not as much. A lot of people write their validation programs by hand. There are some really cool tools that are coming into existence. Pydantic is a great open source tool for doing sort of type verification, and it has Spark support being integrated. TensorFlow data validation is fantastic, except for the part where it's really hard to get it to run. But they're working on that. And that one gives you the ability to write really cool statistical sort of properties and validate those about your data. I think it's really awesome, and I look forward to being able to actually use it. But I think it's important to remember it's okay not to be perfect, right? When we're writing our validation rules, especially, I think we can cut ourselves a little bit more slack with our tests. Flaky tests are kind of bad because we depend on them for sort of that fast feedback loop. But I look at validation as sort of like that last final check before things go out. And that's okay if we sometimes hold things back and just have a human look at it, you know, maybe once a month, that's okay. If a human's looking at it every day, they're just gonna press the big green button every day and not check it. So it's a trade-off. Here's a sample validation rule. There are many different ways to express validation rules. This one is about the records read. Realistically, if you probably only read 1,000 records, things have gone bad. This is not good. There are a bunch of really cool open source packages, Pydantic, like I was mentioning, Spark Testing Base, ScalaCheck, Hypothesis. The Spark upgrade tool is only kind of tangentially related. It's related in that it does a bunch of validation to try and assert that we haven't broken things in the process of upgrading your pipeline. And so I think that's kind of neat. It's a special case where we can actually run two copies of the same pipeline and compare it sort of side by side. And so it's a case where we validate that our code change has not created an unexpected data change. And I think that's sort of a special case of validation, which is kind of fun. if you're interested in some samples, these are some links to some samples. This is not the grocery store. Please copy these samples. Please copy these samples, and improve upon them. I want more tests.